afternoon. My name is Tricia, and we're going to be talking about Smooth Move today. Welcome everyone. Just for those that are in person here, I just wanted to go over a couple of housekeeping things. Right out the hall and to the left is the restroom. It says employees only, but feel free to use that one. And then should there be an emergency and we have to leave the building, you just follow me and Ashley out. So I want to introduce Ashley here in the back.
Hello.
She's my colleague and we'll be doing this briefing today. All right, so let's get started. All right, so here at the Airmen and Family Readiness Center, we have a lot of resources for you during your PCS. And one thing that I wanted to point out is our wonderful new Discovery Resource Center. We just call it the DRC. We've got computers, some are CAC accessible, fax, copier, scanner, printer, and in a lovely room, we've even got a little coffee bar in there. So when you find yourself, you know, a little discombobulated with your household goods being packed up and you just need a place, come on over here. It's open Monday through Friday. It's open Monday through Wednesday from 8 to 12. Thursdays from 8 to 12, and then Fridays from 8 to 3 again. Sorry. So, Airmen and Family Readiness Center. This is what the building would look like in the summertime. We're open 8 to 4 Monday through Friday. 8 to 12 on Thursdays. And we are at 247-2246. Okay, so a couple things before you go, right? Have a yard sale, have a garage sale, if you can. I know this time of year probably is not great for that, but at least try to go through your things and maybe donate to the Airman's Attic, try to sell some stuff at a thrift store, or see if anybody else is in need. Get those things up for sale on Mercari or OfferUp, any of those other things. Especially if you're going to like Kadena, a weight-restricted area, you're only going to be able to take so much with you. And then, of course, once you have met with TMO, there is a possibility to put some stuff in storage if you're going overseas. So there's a lot of information on this slide, but just some tips for before you go. If you're going overseas, you might as well go ahead and get your tourist passports if those are outdated or if you haven't ever had any. All of your important documents, medical records, insurance policies, that type of thing, you want to keep separate from, especially on the day when TMO is coming to pack you out, because those things get packed up. So keep those separate, keep those in the car maybe that day, but maybe get like a folder or something to put all those important documents in. When you find out your new mailing address, if you're going overseas, it's possible that your sponsor could get you a mailbox before you go. If not, maybe you've bought a house or you already know for base housing at your stateside base what your new address is going to be. So you want to make sure that you share that with your family and friends. Also, put in a change of address before you leave if you know. If not, you can use the base's general delivery at the post office on base. Housing options, base housing, renting, buying. You'll want to look at all those type of things depending on your budget, depending on where you're going. If you are going overseas, it's a good idea to go ahead and get your international driver's license. And AAA is who you would contact for that. And don't forget to renew your stateside driver's license before you head out. Even though online it's much easier nowadays, it's just something that you know, you won't have to worry about while you're overseas then. Get your will updated, you can see legal for that. Review all your insurance policies, which you're going to do anyway with vehicles and renter's insurance while you're overseas or stateside if you're buying a new home. And then, of course, if you have not heard of the Service Member Civil Relief Act, go ahead and go to this website and check that out. It is basically an act that covers you while you're overseas from, like, being sued, being put on, when you don't pay your bills, like creditors coming after you. That actually came in handy when I was married and we were overseas and they couldn't touch us, at least for that time period, right? Okay, next slide. Sponsorship. If you don't already have a sponsor, you need to get in touch with your CSS, UPC, or MPF. It's really important, especially if you're going overseas, to have a sponsor, at least, you know, to meet you at the airport and get you going those first few days. If you are stateside, I mean, depending on how you are, you might not need a sponsor, but it's still a good idea to at least have somebody to check in with. If you've never heard of the military installations, it's a website where you can go on and you can find out all kinds of information about your new base. You can see pictures, gives you some tips on schools and housing and all kinds of things for your next base. And it lists all of the bases within the DoD. So if you are going to an Army base, then you can still use this. Additional help while you're in transit, while you're overseas, or just any time that there is an emergency, the Red Cross is going to be who you want to reach out to. This is their number, they're 24/7, 365. And then while you are overseas, you want to get a hold of the Red Cross through your Airmen and Family Readiness Center. Anybody have any questions? All right, so I'm going to turn it over to Rachel, and she's from TRICARE.
Thank you. I guess it's after meeting, isn't it? My name is Rachel Davis. I'm with Health.Federal Services, and I'm a TRICARE beneficiary educator. And so I just want to go over kind of what's going to happen and what not to do when you're PCSing. So depending on whether you're going overseas or relocating to the U.S., there could be some changes to your TRICARE benefits. Is there a clicker up here? Oh, thank you. So stateside. Over here, we're HealthNet Federal Services. There's two regions in the U.S. HealthNet Federal Services manages TRICARE West. Humana is TRICARE East. They have the same coverage across the board. The main difference is your points of contact. So if you're traveling to the East, you will need to contact Humana Military, call them when you get to your final duty destination and get enrolled. And if your family members are going with you, get them enrolled as well. Next slide. TRICARE Overseas Program. So there's three different regions overseas. There's the Latin America and Canada, Eurasia, Africa, and the Pacific. The TRICARE service centers are open overseas. So do not do anything as far as calling HealthNet Federal Services or anything until you get to your final duty destination. Once you get there, you're going to enroll in plan. You're going to get assigned a primary care manager, as well as with your family members. So do not do anything between now and then. You want to keep your assigned PCMs. And then once you get to your final duty destination, then that's when you want to call or go into the overseas offices, and you'll get assigned a PCM over there. Next slide. So getting care during your move. So as you're transitioning, or if you are traveling before you get to your final destination, if there's an emergency, obviously 911 to the nearest emergency room. That's for you and your family members. If you need to get urgent care while you're traveling, you can see any TRICARE authorized provider. You do need to call either your primary care manager and get a referral. Or if you look at the cards that I have passed out, on the back of the cards, it's the National Nurses Advice Line. You can call them 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. They can also get you a referral as well. And the phone numbers for the overseas programs, as well as Health Net Federal Services and Humana Military, are all going to be on the little card as well. And if you flip over the back of the brochures, it's going to have the overseas contacts information as well. And prescriptions, get your prescriptions filled prior to leaving if you can. Express Scripts is who you're going to reach out to if you're going to need to get anything in the meantime, or have them shipped to you, or what military treatment pharmacy is going to be closest for you. Next slide. So DEERS. DEERS is what verifies you and your family members and eligibility for TRICARE. So as soon as you have a permanent address, you need to go on to MillConnect, call Health Net Federal Services, and get that information updated in DEERS. And you can also go to the beneficiary web enrollment to update your information through Health Net Federal Services as well. So here's the contact information, but very important that you're going to keep that information up to date, because that's how they're going to look to make sure that you're going to be eligible in that area for your TRICARE benefits. So just updating the DEERS does not transfer your TRICARE Prime. You're going to still need to call or go into an office, depending on where you're going. If you're overseas, you're going to go to the TRICARE Service Center. If you're relocating somewhere in the States, you're going to call your contractor, either Humana Military or Health Net Federal Service if you're stateside. Otherwise, it's going to be the overseas programs. So as soon as you get to your destination is when you want to call and enroll. And same goes with your family members. If your family members are not traveling with you, they don't need to do anything if they're going to stay in their current plan. Next slide. Overseas program options, which I talked about a little bit. If your families are kind of coming with you and they're command sponsored for overseas, they can do the TRICARE Overseas Program Prime, TRICARE Prime Remote, TRICARE Overseas Select for only family members. If family members are not command sponsored, they're going to be only eligible for TRICARE Overseas Select. Any questions so far? No? Okay. So this is just kind of a recap of what I went over. Do not disenroll from your current plan. Do not have your family members disenroll. Stay enrolled with your PCM that you currently have, with your plan you currently have. When you get to your final duty destination, make your changes. You're going to contact your regional contractor, verify your DEERS information, get new prescriptions filled. If you need to get copies of your medical and dental records, I know that you guys have MHS Genesis here, so that electronically holds your medical records. And make sure that you have your PCM phone number, or you can use the nurse's advice line as well for referrals. And that concludes my TRICARE presentation. Any questions? Thank you very much for your time. Enjoy the rest of the day. It's cold out there.
Good afternoon, everybody. Jack Farber from Housing. Next slide, please. Anybody live on base? Okay, so get with your RS, you know, tell them that you got orders and when you're gonna leave so they can get, get ready for the next tenant. And then schedule all your inspections with your RS and complete the final inspection at the end, complete the change of address cards, and you can complete a advanced housing application if you want to go on base at your next assignment. Next slide, please. Dorms, anybody in the dorms? Nope. Next slide. Off base, so the rest of you guys who live off base, make sure you get with your landlord if you're renting, so he knows that you're leaving. And same thing, you know, cleaning checklists to get out. Of course, you know, get with TMO so you can move. Next slide. CONUS, who's going to CONUS base? Yep, okay. Like to complete the application if you want to live on base there. Update your zip code with finance if you live off base. make sure you keep good records of your expenses and receipts when you PCS. BAH is meant to cover rent and utilities with about 5% out of pocket. Next. This is the 2020 ones. We have the 2021 in. I'm sure, as you know, a lot of them went down, but it shows how much out of OOP is out of pocket expense. So that just shows how much it is. And what these are anchor points. So they're saying an E1 to E4 is going to be a one or a two bedroom apartment. E5s through O2s are going to be a townhouse or a duplex, et cetera, on up the line. So that is how BAH is calculated by anchor points. Next slide, please. Is that it? Nope. Oh, good. You arrive at your new base overseas, get to housing fast. Overseas allowances are very different than BAH. You must see the housing office before entering any lease when you're overseas. Next slide, please. The Service Members Relief Act provides protections for active duty military, guard, and reserve. So make sure that you're familiar with that when you're renting. Next slide, please. Okay, that's it. Any questions?
What does MIHA stand for?
Pardon?
MIHA on the two slides back?
It's an overseas housing type allowance.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a one-time like fee, so you should buy plates and stuff.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Everybody's good? All right. Enjoy the rest of your day.
We're going to talk about voting next. Are you guys going overseas? Where are you guys going?
I'm going to House of Alaska. That's considered a kind of assignment.
Yeah.
It's in the United States.
And then Cheyenne, Wyoming.
Okay. So voting. Okay, so right now, obviously, we're all done with voting, yay, for a while. But obviously, elections are going to come up again later on. So, next slide. So that you know, and this is throughout the Air Force, the Airman and Family Readiness Center normally houses the installation voting reps, and then each unit should have a unit voting rep. So here for us, it is actually Becky Juarez and Blanche Hendershot. And we've got all kinds of information. I don't know if you saw at our front table, all the red, white, and blue stuff. I've got some additional information back here by the coloring books. And your best bet, though, is going to be to go to this fvap.gov website. For a government website, it's fantastic. It's super easy to use. You go on, you pick your state, and it explains everything, how to vote absentee, how to do a mail-in, how to get stuff sent to your next address. It's a really good website. You can also go on to the fairchild.af.mil website and get to it that way. Next slide. Is there a next one? And then just again, fvap.gov. There's a federal write-in absentee ballot. So let's say you don't get your ballot in time. You can request one of these, and if received within 30 days of the election, it'll count the same as an actual ballot. All right, so just make sure that you go to this fvap.gov and you know what your state requirements are. I know from Becky, who is the lead on this for us here at Fairchild, she said about 20 people last year didn't make it in time and they didn't get to vote because they didn't follow the rules for their state on when all the cutoffs are. So make sure that you do, because it's really important that everyone votes. Is there a next slide? That's it. Okay, any questions on voting? Okay. So let's see who we have. We're supposed to have. Hi. Are you from Belfour, maybe?
Wonderful.
Okay.
So I went up. We'll get your slides pulled up.
Okay.
Feel free to take off your mask while you're up there.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, I know. I really do get to hear that. Okay. is Anne Murray. Everything says Martin on my stuff, but I recently got married, so now it's McTeer. So whichever one you hear, if you're moving in or out. Is anyone moving in or off base right now? No? Everyone's off base?
I'm on base.
You're on base?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So I'm the RS for Fort Wright. So if you guys are in Fort Wright area, I'm your main squeeze. So I'm just gonna go over these slides. They're kind of just basic knowledge for moving in and off base. Can change it. So for your application, it says for housing. Yowza. So it is true, not all bases are privatized. We do have a list of Balfour Beatty bases. If you do go to another Balfour Beatty base when you PCS, we do have a coast-to-coast rewards program. That program's kind of cool because we work with the other bases and we can get you $250 off your prorated rent when you move there. Kind of cool, right? So I think that's really the only main thing here. I don't think I need to go through each one there, so we can switch it. So base housing, so when you guys are deciding to move out, we do need a 20-day notice. That is Washington State requirement. So if you get short notice, let us know, we'll work with you. But as soon as you get your orders to PCS to another base or anything like that, we do need 20-day notice, so get it to us as soon as possible. If your lease is up and you're like, hey, I just kind of want to move off base, then we still need that 20-day notice. We do offer pre-inspections. These are really nice because we can come into your home and we can assess damages beforehand, before your actual final. And what this kind of does is sometimes we, you know, you might not be aware of a damage or we may not be aware of a damage, and we can get you quotes instead of waiting to your final. And then you're waiting for those quotes to come in, we can get it all ready for you, and it makes just an easy move out process. And then of course your final inspection, these are pretty simple to when you move in on base. It's the same thing, we take the difference and analyze them. The main things though to know when you move out of base for your final inspection is your trash cans have to be completely emptied and rinsed out. A lot of people are like, oh, it's trash day. Sorry, doesn't work like that. We have to have all of your trash cans cleaned out. And then of course we do two different types of cleans. You can do a self clean or an express clean, which I think that's the next slide. Boom. So your self clean is basically you getting the house ready for the next tenant. Obviously we're gonna come in and fix up the house, make it look a little bit, you know, more presentable. But initially this is like the nitty gritty, like your walls are clean, your baseboards are clean. Think of like an old school white glove inspection sort of thing. They're a little bit more work, but they do save you money, so you don't have to do an express clean. If you choose the express clean, that's totally fine. We have two cleaners that we work with, so if you're ever curious, we can give you that information along with like a similar price sheet in which they go by. With express cleans, you pay, they give us the receipt, and then upon your move out, we just kind of go through damages and that's it. And then they clean after you leave. So you don't actually have to worry about cleaning at all with them, which is kind of nice. And a lot of people use that if it's like a last minute move. And that's all I have for that one. Pets. Pets are a really cool thing to have, but they're also kind of pricey. So just know when you do have a pet, you are responsible for all of the damages that they may cause. So if you do plan on getting a pet or you have a pet and it's not on our books, we need to know about it. Basically, it's a pet addendum. It goes over all the rules. Are you allowed to have cats and dogs, even birds? Some people don't know that. A chicken is not a bird, though. It's considered a farm animal. And I've had people ask me that question, too. And if you are not taking care of your pets, we have to step in. So just love your pets with lots of love. And then a lot of people are remembering our old rules where we have to have them professionally cleaned by you. That's no longer a thing. So they'll charge you a $10 pet deodorizer upon move out for all carpeted areas if you have a pet. So you no longer have to get them professionally cleaned. We do that. We get them professionally cleaned, but we'll pay that and you just do the $10 program. And I think that's, mail. So make sure you change your address. What happens a lot of the times when you guys do move out is people will still send packages to your mailbox, and we do not send them to your new address. So we have to give them back to the post office and basically return to sender. So it's really important that if you're expecting a really important document or a package, that you make sure that you have the appropriate address on there for the time frame in which you're going to be staying at the home or leaving. Next slide. Is there any questions about these slides? Yeah.
About how much is the express plane? Do you have any idea?
It depends on how many rooms how many rooms your house is.
Uh-huh.
Typically, you're looking around $300. On the low rate, and it depends also on the cleanliness of your home. If you have like a really clean spick and span home, they'll just do a flat rate. If you have a very dirty house, they'll probably charge you an extra $50 for a pre-clean, and that basically cleans the walls and the baseboards. Any other questions? No? It's pretty simple, pretty straightforward.
Oh, one more actually, quick. Paint? I painted a wall. Can I get the paint from you guys to paint it back?
Is the original color like the yellow or the gray?
The yellow, yeah.
The yellow. So yeah, they'll give you touch-up paint for the yellow.
Uh-huh.
We also have this thing called the Repose Gray, and that they'll give it to you by the gallon. And then you can paint like a wall gray. You can either paint it that gray or the yellow, either way. But if it's not those two colors, then you will have to paint it back.
Okay.
And you can get touch-up paint. And then if you need more than that little can, they'll probably charge you for it.
Okay.
Okay. You all good? Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. That's pretty quick and easy.
So we're going a little out of order on our, we didn't give you guys agendas. We're going a little out of order. Some briefers aren't here yet. So I'm going to be talking about financial management from an Airman and Family Readiness perspective, not finance. They'll be later on. All right, next slide. So our personal financial counselor here is Blanche Hendershot. We do also have a contracted financial expert. We're in between them right now. So as soon as we get somebody else on board, he or she will also be able to get in the weeds with you as far as your finances and planning for your future. So support and counseling services, confidential, free. You just make an appointment with Blanche and she can help you with financial planning for deployment, a general spending plan, retirement, savings, managing that credit and debt, your TSP and the BRS. Keep in mind, it's always a good idea to have that emergency fund. 28% of Americans don't have an emergency savings. Especially while your pay is going to be in flux, you want to make sure to keep some money aside. I know from my experience it's come in handy, especially going overseas and the pay is all messed up until it gets straightened out. So the suggestion generally is 3 to 6 months worth of income set aside, or about $1,000, or at least $1,000. And then that income needs to be accessible 24/7. So it can't be in some program where it takes 2 to 3 days to pull it out. And so a bank where you can just get it from your ATM. All right. Your pay, finance will be in later, and they'll go over some of your entitlements with that. But just keep in mind that hiccups happen, things happen while you're PCSing. Sometimes it takes a bit for your pay to catch up, so plan ahead for that. Print out a copy of your LES as you go. Of course, nowadays you probably just open up your iPad, your laptop, and can get it that way. Always review your LES monthly for errors. And just keep in mind that that's your responsibility. And then here is the DoD website for rates. Overseas. Is this overseas or stateside?
I believe it is.
Okay. So on your rates as far as BAH and then overseas housing allowance to the OHA. Okay, next slide. Is there a next slide? So please let us help you if you wish to create a spending plan, a budget. We can talk about your base pay, your BAH, your COLA overseas, your income. Talk about what your cost of living is, especially looking at it from your new assignment perspective. So please call Blancha at 247-2246. If you have any questions on that. And then just keep in mind, it's always a good idea at least once a year to ask for your own credit report. And then these are just some of the, you know, the three big ones. And then here's where you can go, and every year you can get a free one through this annual credit report and my FICO here. And just some, you know, things to think about as you are PCSing, renting, buying, whatever your option is going to be. Renting both stateside and overseas, you know, that initial first, last security deposits, that's where your MEHA, your moving and housing allowance, is really going to come in handy for that. But of course, setting up your utilities, there's some costs there associated with that you might not be planning for, but especially with your internet and your cable and your electricity usually. Don't forget that overseas you can get some loaner furniture until your stuff arrives. Some of it you can keep the whole time that you're stationed there, depending on where you're going. And then just keep in mind, are you gonna need an additional vehicle? If you wait till you get over there to buy it, that's another cost that you're going to come into. Make sure that you just notify all of your creditors of your new address. I'm sure you can update those all online, and phone numbers and how to get in contact with you, so that you don't skip any payments, so that your credit stays okay while you're PCSing. Okay, so that's the last slide for the financial portion.
Next, we have the school liaison officer.
Yes, Mr. Steve McMullen is next.
I haven't briefed in a long time in this room, but I used to work over here. So my name is Steve McMullen, and I am the school liaison assigned to Fairchild. But I've also worked EFMP. So how many of you guys have children that are moving with you? Great, so we do have a few, and you, ma'am, do not, right? How many of you are going over and you're going to be supervising other airmen? Or at least you'll have other airmen that you talk to. So, how many of you know what EFMP is? Can you tell me what EFMP is, sir? Exceptional Family Member Program. How many, do you know how many parts there are to EFMP?
No.
Okay, there are three parts to EFMP. So, in this work center at AFRC, and this is the same for every base you're gonna go to, you have the EFMP / FS, or family support, right? So that person will help airmen get services. It's resource and referral, right? So that's kind of what Becky Juarez does here. You will have another EFMP person assigned at your other location. So EFMP is a mandatory program. You can't not decide that you don't want to be EFMP, right? It's not really, it's a mandatory program for everybody. Doesn't matter who you are, doesn't matter if you are a colonel, a general, or whatever, if you are in the armed forces, you are going to have an EFMP. So what that means is that your dependent, generally your spouse or your children, have some special needs, right? It could be as minor sometimes as like asthma, or as major as like Down syndrome, autism, things like that, right? I can't tell you if you qualify, but the EFMPM over at the medical group, all medical groups have one of those too, is going to be able to tell you whether, you know, you qualify for the program. And then there is EFMPA or assignments. So if you're EFMP, you are going to have a Q code, that's a limitation code, assigned to the active duty member. That's going to tip off AFPC that, hey, we need to take a little bit of a closer look at this person because they have some limiting factors. We can't just send their whole family to, oh, I don't know, Turkey or wherever if there aren't services there to help you be successful. So when you are talking with your troops, right, when you're out there, maybe you're doing a, you know, talking at a commander's call or things like that, the big tickets are this. It's a mandatory program. You can't just say that I don't want to be EFMP. It does not work like that. Now, once you're assigned a Q code, you can get rid of the Q code once the limiting factors are cleared up. So we know a couple of things. Well, so let's say you have a medical condition that will be cleared up in X amount of time. Maybe you're going through cancer treatment or something like that. And after the cancer treatment is over, right, and you're cleared, then maybe you can get rid of that Q code. You can't just say, I don't want it. You have, there's a process to go through. But things like autism that never go away, right, that would be attached to you as long as you're active duty. Does that make sense? So the place to go for lots of information about this would be the Airman and Family Readiness Center. So when you're out there, and if you're at Kadena, I know the EFMP coordinator there, right? If you have a troop and they're like, hey, you know what, my child is kind of struggling in school, he needs some speech and maybe some other therapies, I don't know what to do next, send them over to the AFRC or to the med group, right? Have them talk to those people about Q codes and EFMP. Because really, it does help the troop out. It does help the member out, right? And a lot of people will say, well, you know, if I get on that, then I'm not going to be able to advance through my career. Well, two commanders ago, right, he had a Q code, he had a child who had Down syndrome, right? Pretty limiting, right? Well, he was a colonel here and now he's a general. So that really doesn't, that's really not an excuse not to be, you know, registered in it. Okay, so when you're out there giving your briefings, doing all that, and you're thinking, that Steve guy, he kind of said that it's a mandatory program. I need to talk to this troop about that, right? That's all you have to do. That's all you need to do. Just point them in the right direction. Okay, let's see. I don't read off slides. I've just been doing this so long. I want to make sure that I'm covering everything that I need to cover. Okay, is there a next slide to this, Ashley?
This is the last one.
Okay, Becky Juarez. So when you're traveling, if you got any issues before you're traveling or anything like that, contact Becky. Becky is awesome. I've worked with Becky for 20 years out here at Fairchild. So super awesome gal. Get hooked in with her if you need any help or if you have any questions over at EFMP before you travel. You're going to Minot. Have fun down there. That's going to be a blast. nice and cold. Kadena, should be an awesome assignment. And you're going to Osan. Are you on a just a tour by yourself then for a year, right? Unaccompanied. I've heard really good things about Osan. I hear it's just fabulous there. So enjoy yourself there. So let's move on to school liaison. And I don't necessarily need slides for this either. Are you hooked in with the school liaison at your receiving bases?
I've already received an email from one of the...
Great. About you?
No.
You, sir? No. You had dependents, children?
Yeah, they're going to be going to off-base schools, though. So.
They're going to off-base schools? Do you know anything about the schools?
My wife's Japanese. So.
There you go. You're hooked in. So for those who haven't hooked in with the school liaison, so here's the deal. Before you hit the ground, when is your report date?
May 31st.
May 31st. I want you to email me with where you're going. I will get you the contact information for the school liaison at the receiving base, and they will get you hooked in. My job is to make sure that on the receiving end, when you guys come here, that I'm hooking you up with the resources that you need so that your kids can get enrolled in schools. I also help with any kind of issues that happen in the schools and the districts and everything like that. It's pretty complex stuff when you start talking state to state, state transfers and everything. So one of the things I tell people, get an unofficial copy of your child's records, right? The school districts can make copies of this and carry this. They'll send it to your new school district, but sometimes that takes a long time. So get copies of that. Immunization records, they're gonna have to have those. Birth certificates, depends on what age your child is, but birth certificates generally are a needed thing when you're registering. And then I have a checklist for moves that I can send to each of you guys. If you guys just email me, I'll send you that checklist. That'll explain everything. And then I will give you the points of contact for the school liaison at your receiving base. There's a school liaison at every single base in the Air Force, and it is armed forces wide. So if you're stationed at an Army post or a Marine installation, there's going to be a school liaison there. And they're going to do pretty much the exact same thing that I'm going to do for you. We're going to hook you in with the schools. One of the things that people ask me is, what's the best school, right? Well, that's not really my job to tell you what the best school is, because if I tell you what I think is the best, you go there and you hate it, right? It's not going to work out well for my work. So I can guide you into certain arenas, like let's say you want private schools, right? I know most people who work in private schools. I know the administrators, right? And I can kind of guide you along the way. Same goes for school districts. The school liaison has contacts in those school districts that can help you get the information you need, plus there's report cards and everything. So reach out to your school liaison before you get there. They'll take care of you. If you need things on my end, or I can even, if you send me an email, you know, I know that time's short. May's right around the corner pretty much, right? If time's short, I can give a warm handoff. I can say, hey, look, Tech Sergeant Statley, right, is heading your way. He's got two kids. They're in these grades. Please help them out. And they'll get back to you through email. However you guys want to work that, I can handle that on my end and just help you guys move along and be successful with the next mission. Any questions for me for right now? Okay, so we know EFMP is mandatory. We know you have a school liaison. We know that it's kind of resource and referral for EFMPFS, but there are three parts. So, and there is, if you get into a jam with EFMP, there are such things as humanitarian moves, like if the base just isn't working out, if you can't handle the services are too far away, let's say you're traveling 150, 200 miles for services for your kiddo, you can get humanitarian moves, but it's a long process. So it's not out of the question, though. And for schools, make sure you get your kids enrolled. Most states do have truancy laws, right? So here it's 10 days, right? If you have unexcused 10-day absences for your children, you fall under the truancy laws of the state. And, well, I've seen cases where people actually have done jail time for it, for keeping their kids out of school. So it does happen, highly unlikely. And then you guys, what, you're going to Dakotas, and you guys are going where?
F.E. Warren.
So Wyoming, right? So, and you're going to Kadena. So for you guys, once you send me an email, you gotta look up the Military Interstate Compact Commission, right? Because it's good for all 50 states here. And it has a lot of benefits, like pre, post, post-deployment and PCS types of things. You get some extra time to get things settled down, right? There's also a lot of other benefits. For those of you guys going overseas, that doesn't apply to you, because that's just stateside. Lastly, I'll just tell you a great program here. Maybe Trish has covered it, PCS for PCS childcare?
Yeah.
Okay, so PCS childcare. If you have kids, it's really, really great. So on the leaving end, the losing base, you get 20 hours of free childcare per child, right? Generally in an FCC home, but 20 hours free to pack up and stuff like that. You have to contact Nancy Keaton on this end. So here's the flyer down at the bottom for that. Huge benefit. I mean, you got a couple of kids, 40 hours of free care that you don't have to pay for, it isn't a bad deal, right? So the other great thing about that is that it also applies on the gaining end. But you're gonna have to hook up with the FCC coordinator or AFRC to get that process started. Don't let that benefit go to waste, guys, because that's super, super beneficial. When you can receive 40 hours of care or 20 hours of care to unpack, kind of, especially if you've got littler kids, that's a real big benefit. So, any questions over anything from me? All right, so you got my name, you got my phone number, you got my email address. Shoot me an email if you need some help. Otherwise, best of luck to all of you in your new assignments, and we'll be listening to you guys here at Fairchild. Have a great day.
Thanks,
Tricia.
Okay. I'll leave these for you.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah,
good. Super, thanks a million.
So we're going to take a 10-minute break, and then we'll get started back. So feel free to use the restrooms, get a drink. Oh, we have coffee back here if you're interested. And, yeah, so we'll be 10 minutes. We'll be back. I'll come around and collect if you're ready, everyone.
So I'm Tim Hoff, and I'm one of the MFLAX on base. There are currently only three of us. One of our colleagues decided to move on to other spaces. It's been a significant loss. It really has been. She's terrific. So we're hoping that someone will be coming in behind her soon, but so far on the adult side, I'm it. So it's probably, I spent most of my life in academics, working with graduate students and that kind of stuff. And so I ended up here because I have a Korean daughter who married a guy in the army, for which we forgive her. And
thanks.
They had three children, and all of them, well, certainly below the age of four. Right? So an infant, one was about 2.5, and maybe one about 3.5, something like that. And she ended up, they were at Fort Hood, and so she spent that 1.5 years single parenting, you know, and it was tough for her. And someone had mentioned the MFLAX to her, so she went to talk to someone, and I guess they were pretty good, because she really liked them. And I had retired from my previous life and was enjoying my horses and my puppy dogs and my pine trees, and she got on me about it and said, you know, you probably ought to be doing something. And I said, well, I am. I mean, I'm having a good time. And she said, no, you have credentials and you ought to be using them. So here I am. I told her to send me a bunch of stuff, you know, like about the program, which isn't her business to do. And I figured I'd never seen anything, and God, I got a packet about that thick, you know. And she calls me 3 days later and says, have you gone through that packet yet? I mean, she's never going to let go. She's never going to let go of it, right? When I asked her why, basically, I think she meant what she said. Well, she was afraid that if I just vegetated, I'd die. And that kicked me. That kicked me in the rear to get moving. So here I am, and you have to listen to it, right? So the MFLAC program. As you know, we all have master's or doctoral degrees, and we are licensed in the state of Washington to practice. And the difference is we don't practice, right? We don't do that. Which didn't make sense to me in the very beginning. It's like, why have someone having to have a license and degrees and you don't want them to practice? Well, here's the thing. You know, it is true. We don't, we don't document, hooray, which means I'm not sitting there pretending as if I'm listening to you while madly writing notes to cover my backside for the next, you know, soul that comes in, because you gotta write up copious amounts of stuff. And I didn't have to diagnose, and I didn't have to test and do all those things that I had been programmed to do, but found the most tedious part of my job. So actually, I get to listen to people, actually listen and have a conversation with people, right? And so the beauty of it is just that you have someone that has to maintain confidentiality or they're going to lose their job. And so you can pretty much go in and say most anything other than threatening, you know, things that are duty to warn stuff like harm to self and harm to others, and or things that are mandated as reportable, like, you know, sexual abuse, child abuse, those things. Those things have to be reported. Everything else, no. So wherever you're going, there are going to be an MFLAC, or more than one. Okay? Even at Minot, they might have them. I mean, you're going to freeze your tuchus off, but you know, that's life. I just want to say. I have friends that spent 3 years there. Actually, one of them really liked it. He thought it was an okay place, but you know, I suppose the only place that can get that cold, get as cold or colder, is probably Fairbanks and that environs. It's whoa. I've been there in the winter. You have to learn to breathe there. That's the important part, which is if you step out the door and take a deep breath, you're in trouble. Seriously, your system's shut down. It'll quit. So you got to go slowly into it and start the breathing. Like stand out there and don't move. Just take short breaths and then begin to expand the amount of it so it gives you enough gas to get to where you got to get to. But it's, oh boy. And it's beautiful. It's the one, you know how you have bucket lists, right? One of mine was that I always wanted to run a dog sled team. I got to do that. It was great. It was one of the most wonderful experiences I've ever had. It was terrific. So that's nothing to do with MFLAC. So the MFLAC business is here to help you with any kind of problem solving or issues that may be going on with you and your family. So this is for your family as well. I mean, PCSing is maybe not as harsh in some ways, although maybe you don't want to leave an area in some cases, but you know, it causes some rumbling sometimes with your kids or with your spouse or with your friends, people you're leaving behind. And it's not a bad idea to talk to somebody about that stuff to get some input from someone who isn't a part of the problem, okay? And that's what we're here for. So we're here to support you and do the best we can. We have little business cards and I'll leave some up there. But if we can be of help to you in some way, great. And don't forget they're gonna be at the other end. There'll be people there as well. We're all very different, but we are all qualified at what we do. You know, we'll all have different approaches, all of those things. But I have yet to meet an MFLAC that didn't have an investment in really trying to help people. Those who didn't left, you know, they left, they didn't last. So you're gonna have good folks, you know. So make use of it. You know, your paycheck may not be that great, but if you start taking advantage of all the things that you get in this system, man, your benefits are beyond my wildest dreams. You know, when you finally someday retire or whatever, you will take a look back and go like, oh, I missed some of those benefits, right? So take care, have a good life, enjoy yourselves. You know, have fun, look at it as an adventure, and if we can be of help, let us know, okay? Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yep.
Thank you. Okay, so next up we have Sergeant Foreman, who's also on a class from Legal.
Hi, I'm Sergeant Foreman. I work in the Fairchild Legal Office. I am the NCRC of Readiness and Operations Law. I also worked as NCRC of Civil Law here, and I'm qualified to tell you about claims. Next slide, please. They're located at Wright Pet. They are mostly civilians, but they are there. They're not like a computer-operated thing. Like, they are actually humans who are actively working any claim that you may put in. And they're extremely helpful. Even when I first got here, I worked with them, and now I'm going overseas, and I still will reach out to them if I have any questions about shipping things and something breaking. Slide. High value items, make sure you make a list. Make sure you write down serial numbers. Make a video or take photos. I took photos of all my serial numbers on all my TVs and things like that, like gaming consoles. Make sure you do that. One of the issues with allowing others to move your items for you is one of the first claims I had when I got here, the guy PCS'd from here or to here or something. Either way, he allowed his spouse to pack for him because he was in training, and one of his like 17 guns or something was stolen, like one of the bigger ones. Make sure whoever is moving for you knows that those things are there. If they're gonna pack them inside of boxes because they're thinking it's gonna be safe, we don't know. These are outside companies that are being hired. So make sure you're taking pictures, writing down the list, verifying the list with them. What they say may take a 30 minute, I think I took almost 3 hours going through all of my items with them because they were missing items constantly. And if I would have gotten here and those items weren't there, then it would have been a bad day. So make sure you're taking the time to go through. This is the list of super important things, and then this is the list as they go through it. Next slide. Same thing here, even like small items. So again, take pictures and videos of things. Make sure the inventory shows the numbers of items being shipped. Don't ship it if you can hand carry it. For those PCSing stateside, like for me, I just call local law enforcement, got legal advice from my attorneys, and I was able to travel with like my jewelry and my guns. If you're going overseas, that's not really as easy. So make sure you're talking with the legal office stateside, legal office where you're going. Set up a plan for things that you can't take with you, and make sure that even the smallest of items, such as jewelry, is annotated. If you can hand carry it though, that's better. Put it inside of a box and take it with you. Next. Again, third slide. Photos and videos again. So make sure movers list the totes, contents, and inventory. Review the inventory before you sign it. So it may be easier to talk to them when they initially get there to say, let's go room by room. If you have a bigger house, or maybe section it off for them. It's easier if you go ahead and section, okay, this room I put all my clothes. So now that they're packing my clothes, these are all of my clothes. This room I put all of my TVs. This room I put just different things. Organizing it, making sure you know what you have. The inventory, take time and make sure inventory is accurate and complete before you sign. If you see any errors, correct them before you sign them. It may seem like they're frustrated because they've been there all day and they're tired. It's okay. They're being paid to be there. They will be just fine. So make sure you go through it with them. I wish I had mine as an example, but I made them rewrite stuff and they were not happy about it, but I don't care because it's my things, right? Make sure you think about these being your things, because we can't do anything if you hand us an inventory list and the guns or whatever you have, is jewelry isn't there, but you're saying it was in there and you signed. Next, please. High risk, high value inventory are not just these little things here, right? It's things that you consider extremely important. Like even if it's something small, and someone may say, oh, I can get something similar to that for like 10 bucks off Amazon, but maybe you spent $600 on it at something because it belonged to someone important. You know, make sure you're paying attention to those little things. For purposes of determining the TSP's liability, all such items shall be deemed to weigh at least 1 pound. TSP is a transportation service provider, is whoever we hire, and it's always gonna be someone different, so don't ever think it's the same company doing it. And their liability is only $100 per pound of an article if you fail to inform the TSP as in writing. So this ring, while it may cost way more than $100, is less than a pound. So think about it that way. High risk, high value inventory, usually separate from inventory. Review it carefully. You and the TSP must open all containers upon leaving arrival inventory and physically inspect before signing, which is why they pack everything up with you and why they unpack everything with you. Next slide, please. Delivery day. Hopefully your delivery day does not look like this, but it can. So make sure you're like watching them pack it up and making sure they're packing it up properly. Next slide. Filling out the notice of loss or damage delivery. These are the front of the 1850 and the 1840. Make sure, I know I feel like I'm repeating it, but please make sure you're reading these documents when there's like damage. I showed up here and I was missing a whole table, right? So make sure you're paying attention to these things, because although they wrote table, what I didn't realize was that they took it apart and screws had came out. So the top, the counter granite thing of the table was missing, but the legs were there that they had put the sticker on and marked this table. So of course it took like a minute for them to realize like, oh, I guess there was something that was there. Like, okay, where is it? So pay attention to those things. And even if you have to break it down saying, hey, there's two pieces, even though it's one piece. Next. Filling out the notice of loss or damage after delivery. Again, we understand you're tired. They're gonna probably sit there with you for however many hours unpacking, and they've done this a million times, so they're gonna write it out with you and help you out. Most of the time they're not like scamming type people, because we're hiring them. So they're definitely gonna help you out with making sure you get it done. However, the submitting portion, when you get to the website, move.mil, to submit anything that comes in broken, damaged, stolen, make sure you hit the submit button. Not sure why some people don't hit the submit button, and then they're waiting, and then they come into our office and we hit the submit button with them. So please hit the submit button. You can do all this from home. They must be notified within 75 days from delivery that something is broken, damaged, whatever. And the reason why it might seem a little long is because they understand, right? We are high tempo deployers, even at this installation, TDYs, things like that. Things happen, you're a little busy. I don't have 5 days because I gotta get my kids enrolled. I gotta do this, I gotta do that, right? So you have 75 days to notify them. Next, please. Hit submit, right? See it all the way down. Please hit submit, refresh the page, do something, hit submit. All right, next. For replacement value, they can repair the item if repairable. They can replace the item with a new or comparable item, pay you cash to replace the item. And you have 75 days to notify and 9 months to file the claim. Next slide. Okay, so one part of that is like it says 9 months and 2 years. That's recently been extended due to COVID. So even though it says 9 months and 2 years, a lot of the carriers are more up to date on what their company is doing as far as paying you back and making sure they get you what you need. So I believe the 2 years, I think each added maybe about 3 to 6 months. We haven't gotten official notification of that, but the carriers are on that because they don't want to do too much in and out of a person's home within shorter amounts of time. Defense personal property system must notify within 75 days, still must file a claim within 9 months. Next slide. And this is what the website looks like for non-DPS for placement value claims. And you just put the information in there. Next slide. If you can't settle with them, you can file those unresolved claims through Air Force Claims Service Center, the people at RightPath. You'll be paid under normal depreciation rules. Claims Service Center will assert full placement value against the moving company. If they recover full placement value from them, you'll be paid an additional amount. If your TSP denies liability and places it on a prior handler, such as a warehouse where they pick up your shipment, you may be eligible to receive full replacement value from the Claims Service Center. Again, put down those numbers, 986-8044 if you're calling from your work computer, or 877-754-1212. I haven't done the DSN, but I do call the 1212 number, and I talk to the individuals there. So I know for sure the people answer on that one. Next slide. TSP's liability under full replacement value is at $5,000 per shipment, or $4 per net weight of shipment, up to $50,000. This is an overseas type shipment. I don't know how real that is, but these things could happen. So that's a liability we have. Call the Claim Service Center if the claim amount is greater than or near these limits, and they'll work through these with you all day long. That's their job, is to work on how we ship to military members things and where it went missing. Next slide. And then there's the 9 months, and if you don't file, you can do a depreciated value within 2 years. Not entitled to full replacement value, but claims still adjudicated. 2 year statute of limitations. It says it's not waiverable, but recently due to COVID, it is. Next slide. Following your claim with the Air Force, you can go through claims.jag.af.mil and you can get information on claims as they come out. Next slide. POV damage claims, different process than filing for household goods damage. Follow the TMO guidance for your vehicle drop-off. Strict rules on vehicle conditions at drop-off, pickup at port, thoroughly inspect. Do not let them rush you. Like I said earlier, they may seem like, okay, we're tired. You're like our third house we've moved today. Who cares, right? The Air Force is paying them per house to move your stuff for you. Doesn't matter. Same thing with your vehicle. it could be raining. Well, we're gonna have to figure this out. So let's find somewhere and we're gonna go through it, because if you drive off and you didn't annotate something, it's a lot harder for us to get payment back. We had one guy, he spent like a couple of hours there initially trying to argue it out himself before he called Air Force members. But had he left, he would have been, and just given up, he would have been out of the money, because he left his car in storage and the rats ate up his wires and stuff when it was supposed to be a sealed container. So please, please, please do not let them rush you. It does not matter how they feel about the day. This is your vehicle. These are things that are important to you. And it's going to be on the form, DD form 788, for shipping and the inspection forms. Next. No any and all damage, right? Right, that looks crazy, right, to have all these things there, but you'd rather have them there than not, because if you brought a brand new vehicle, put it in storage, or shipped it, and it was like perfect, and then it gets there looking like this, you're not going to want to pay for a single dent or scratch, right? So make sure you fill it out. And then that's what the two sides look. And then make sure you can report it to us. Ultimately, we're just going to tell you to report it to the claim service center. So you can send a copy to us as well as the claim service center. And it says contact the base legal to inspect your POV. That's in the event that something is like crazy going on and maybe your pictures aren't coming out correctly. What sometimes the claim service center will do after talking to you will have you, or they will talk to us about going out with our cameras and whatnot and getting a better or different, necessarily saying you did anything wrong, but it's to help provide more or a clearer view of what it is that was damaged. Next, please. Same thing there. See the vehicles down there. So acceptance of payment may be considered final settlement and will prevent you from being compensated later. And that's on both sides, not just POVs, but your household goods. So if you accept payment from them at that time, nothing else can be done later. All right, next. So these are a couple of reasons why your claim could be negatively impacted. Right, I like to point out the fifth one, signed inventory listing, entire baseball collection marked as lamp. Right, so you put something in the box and you put the cards around it, and the cards are important to you, but you just put lamp because that's what the cards are protecting, is that lamp, right? Things like that, that people often do and they don't think about. Or you let them put just a plastic, one plastic container, because they have to place everything inside of boxes. One plastic container, and that's all they put, and they put it inside those boxes. And when they go put it in storage while they wait for you or while they're shipping it or whatever, but it's full of expensive silverware. Things like that are really common where we need you to pay attention on the front end, and then on the back end, not clicking submit and then not using the DPS and missing the deadlines for filing when we give you 2 years or more, right? Those things. Forgetting to list damages to your Ferrari prior to leaving the port, right? So, those things. Next slide. These are some of the people that work there. I think there's a little more now. Air Force is getting a little bigger. You can send them letters. They respond to letters. You can email them. And you can call their number again there. One thing I like to know, we've recently had people running into situations where they, I'm not sure why, maybe you or your airmen or co-workers, trying to ship things on their own for reimbursement purposes later, which can be done, but make sure you're looking at who's shipping it. Because we ran into an issue where an airman PCS here, but use a company that was like, I don't think they were a real company, and we had to deal with that, unfortunately. And they took all of his stuff. So, with that being said, if you're gonna do something like that and PCS all your stuff yourself, and then ask for reimbursement, work with TMO on how to do that. Be active about it, be aggressive about it, and don't get into the business of, okay, these people are charging me $50 an hour to move my whole house. So, hey, it's cheaper, but no. So make sure you're asking the questions you need to ask before doing it. Next. Is that the last one? Okay. Thank you.
State lines, it has to have a health certificate. What this is basically I'm saying, all right, this animal does not have any sort of a disease that it's going to spread across state lines. When it's interstate, usually it's not too bad. It's just that health certificate and it's rabies certificate. And you do need the original rabies with the blue ink signature. That is a key piece that will get your pet stuff a lot of times. You can get a health certificate at any clinic. Here on base, we actually go ahead and help you guys out with that as well. If you could go ahead and give me the next slide. Okay. So we do offer a lot of different services here. What I'm gonna be mostly focusing on today is gonna be those health certificates. But we can always do, get you guys set for travel before you go with just the exams, vaccinations, everything there. We are currently not doing any sort of anesthesia procedures just with COVID and all the things, but next slide. So as I was saying, focusing mostly on the health certificates, interstate's a lot easier. International is where you can end up with 180 days or 200 days of just working to get your pet in the country. So that's actually what I'm doing right now with Japan, which is fun.
What about traveling through? So I am going to Alaska and I'll travel with my own vehicle, but spend the rest of my time in TMO. I'll probably keep my pets with me. But traveling across country lines but not staying in those countries, is that
You'll want to check out and make sure that, because they can stop you at the border potentially. Thankfully, Canada actually is pretty much like an interstate. They go, all right, you have your rabies, you have your health certificate, on you go. Canada as well, though, just make sure that you have orders because they are stopping people on the border and saying, no, you're American, go away. Canada's fairly easy. A lot of countries, as long as you've got the next ticket, they'll make exceptions, but sometimes they will go, if you're there for too long, they'll be like, you have to meet the requirements. Okay. You can always look up as well on your own. That website down at the bottom of the page is the USDA website. It has something where you can punch in where you're traveling to, and it'll bring it right up. The international requirements can change even overnight sometimes, so it's always good to check and make sure on your own as well, making sure that that's staying up to date. All right, go ahead, next slide. We are just right over here on the corner, catty corner to the school and the fitness center. So we're right there. We've got the contact information there as well. Casey is welcome. Welcomes questions all the time to help you through that. All right, did you need a second mark like that? All right, next slide.
That's it.
All right, that's it. So thankfully we don't have any international except myself, so that's pretty short and sweet.
I've already been working on mine.
We're gonna go ahead and take another 10-minute break because one of our briefers didn't show up and the next one isn't until 20 after. So go ahead and take another 10-minute break if you'd like.
Hey guys, so I recently PCS'd and I'm having to take care of a bunch of stuff, like checking out my new digs and sending my family my new address, because y'all know I want those care packages. I also met with a bunch of the people in my unit and they're pretty chill. One of them actually told me about a bunch of forms I need to fill out to vote absentee in the next election. As you all may know, if you're active duty and stationed away from home, you can still vote. So I sat down with my voting assistance officer here and got a bunch of info. Most units have one. If you do have one, well then consider them your POC for this kind of stuff. If you don't have one, well then today's your lucky day, because I'm here. The process seemed kind of confusing at first, but I've got the steps down now, so I figured I'd go through the process with y'all. All right, I got this form from my voting assistance officer. It's called the Federal Postcard Application. Probably just easier to remember FPCA, but whatever floats your boat. It lets you register to vote and request an absentee ballot from your home state. Then your state will send you a ballot wherever you're stationed. The VAO told me to do a new one every year or when I either move or deploy. He also told me to do one 3 months before an election just to make sure everything's good to go. I also know you can find and fill out this form on the website for the Federal Voting Assistance Program. That's fvap.gov. I'm just gonna leave that right there in case you forget everything I'm about to say, because you can just go to fvap.gov and figure it out from there. But my VA already gave me this form, and it's got this built-in handy envelope with postage paid. All right, so it starts with the straightforward ID stuff, classification, name. All right, y'all don't need to sit through this stuff. All right, that was pretty easy. The only parts I needed to check on were voting residence and current address. The back of the form asked me to check out my state guidelines, which I found on fvap.gov. So it's gonna ask you for two addresses. The first one is gonna be your last address in your state of legal residence, even if you don't live there anymore. The second one is gonna be your current mailing address, and then they'll send your ballot to that address. All right, I'm done filling this thing out and I'm about to send it off. I could send this thing by email to the election office, but I don't have a scanner. So I'm just gonna sign it and send it in using this postage paid envelope. Just check and see what your state allows on the website and make sure you sign before you send. Also, even if you don't email the form, you should include your email address just in case the election office needs to get in contact with you in case you're missing anything. So yeah. All in all, that only took me about, what, 10 minutes? Now all I have to do is wait for my absentee ballot. Just kidding. I'll be back when my ballot arrives before the election.
Good afternoon. My name is Christina. I am from the Traffic Management Office, Traffic Management Flight, TMO, Personal Property, House of Goods, whatever you want to call it. We're the office that you come to when you get your orders or get an assignment and you need to make arrangements for your flights and or your house or goods shipments. So, address is on the board. We're in the same building as finance. That's the main thing that you just need to know. Just find us, we're in that same building. Okay, next slide. Okay, for those of you that are going internationally and or Alaska, it is considered a international flight. You are required to submit a port call request so that we can book you on your military flight going overseas. The Alaska ones, you will not have a military flight, but you are still required to submit the form because Alaska is considered an international assignment. So if you haven't done that, please do that as soon as you can. The reason why we need this is because your flights open up prior to your actual departure. We want to make sure that we get you and a pet scheduled on a flight. So please make sure you contact us as soon as possible. You do not need your orders to do this, which is why we want you to do it as soon as you get notified of your assignment. Go ahead to the next slide. Okay, I kind of already touched on it. If you are planning on taking a pet with you, you need to have that request into us as soon as possible, mainly because pet spots are a hot commodity. They are first come, first served. Literally, if the seats open up on a Monday, they could be gone by Monday afternoon because everybody in the world is trying to get that seat for their traveler. So the sooner you get me your port call request, the better I can guarantee you a seat or flexibility on what date you are traveling. Any questions? Okay, go ahead to the next slide. Okay, next question is, hey, when do I start my house or goods move? You can start your house or goods moves as soon as you get orders. You do not need to wait until the month prior. We prefer that you come into our office as soon as possible after receiving your orders because we do have peak seasons. Time will fly. You'll go, oh, it's been a month that I've had my orders. You're not guaranteed to get your pickup dates. The sooner you come into us, the sooner you are briefed, and the sooner you have signed your paperwork, the more better chance I can guarantee the dates you want, okay? So it's very, very important. Right now it says 21 days notice. That 21 days notice is actually changing to a 28 days notice. So if you want to get a particular date, you need to make sure that you come into us as soon as possible. The reason being is, think of it this way. If you are going internationally, you need to meet an international flight. That means that you need to have made arrangements for your vehicle. You need to have made arrangements for your house of goods to be picked up, your unaccompanied baggage shipment, your long-term storage if you're going to do that. There are multiple dates. If you have to clear out of housing, you can't do that until you have your house of goods picked up. If you need to clear out of an apartment, same thing. There's timelines for everything, and the sooner you contact us, the better off we are in guaranteeing your move date. Because otherwise, there may be a delay, and unfortunately, missing a military flight doesn't mean that you automatically get to fly commercially somewhere, okay? Yes, sir?
If you have your RIP, you can't do anything until you get orders.
I can't do anything with RIP. I need the orders because the order tells me your entitlements. It tells me what your rank is, what your dependency status is. It also tells me if you're serving an accompanied, unaccompanied tour, and where you're going, and most importantly, that line of accounting. I can't do anything without that funding. But the minute you get your orders, please contact us. If you are PCSing, you actually don't even have to wait. Go ahead to the next slide. Go ahead to the next one. I think we have it up here. This slide right here. If you get your orders, you can self-counsel your stuff. Rather than coming into the TMO office, you can log on to that website at www.move.mil. Log in to your DPS account. You probably haven't used it since your last PCS, but just follow the instructions for, hey, I forgot my password. Go in. You can actually create your own move request, get your own counseling. The only thing that you'll have to then do is finalize the paperwork with our office, and we'll get it submitted. But same thing, you can't start that process until you have your orders. Are you able to go back a slide? Okay. So the difference is, depending on where you're going, this is the type of shipments you are entitled to. And this is why it's kind of important that you know what you're doing and what your timelines are. If you are moving domestically, you are entitled to do a government shipment and entitled to do a self-move or a combination of the two. So that means the government comes in and picks up the majority of your stuff. You can self-move small stuff that you're going to have in your car that you need right away when you get to the destination. So say you have kids. You want to make sure you have all your kids' stuff to keep them happy while you're living in lodging or TLF or temporary housing until your shipment gets there and can be delivered. Now, if you're going internationally, you're entitled to house of goods, an unaccompanied baggage shipment, a non-temporary storage shipment. That means long-term. So for those of you, like you're going to Kadena, probably a 3 or 4 year tour, if there's property you don't want to take to Japan with you, you could leave it here in Spokane for that duration and the government covers the expense, okay? Because we're not suggesting that you get rid of furniture or stuff that you can't take with you, but that is an option. But that means that that is three different sets of dates that we need to do those moves. Plus, you've got that POV, shipment or storage. So in Japan, you can't take a vehicle with you. If you're serving an unaccompanied tour into like Adana or Guam, same thing. One country will allow you to ship a vehicle, one country won't. So you have to know what your options are. Plus, you can also mail things to yourself. We don't recommend it because you're normally not covered 100%, but it's worth trying if you have some last minute stuff that you need to get to yourself and you can't stick it into your checked luggage that you're gonna take on the airplane with you. Okay, question.
With my personal case where I can still drive through Canada to Alaska, what of those entitlements cross over?
So you are entitled to have the, even though you're international, you are considered for CONUS when you ship.
Okay.
Because you can have the government do the majority of the property, and then you can load up your vehicle to the max, you can get a rental trailer, and you can go. But that's why you want to come to us and find out. For you, I would question your ability to drive right now during COVID. You need to know your international border crossing restrictions. You need to know weapons restrictions going into Canada if you have any. And you need to make sure that you have enough gas and cash on hand when you're driving, because some of the times gas stations are closed. And with COVID, I don't know what it's like from here up to there, because there's a 600-mile stretch that it's a lonely stretch of road if you break down. Okay? Question in the back.
Yes, we have a question online. It is for starting the process. What are the advantages and disadvantages to visiting the TMO office versus doing the online process at move.mil?
The advantage of coming in person is you kind of get a little bit of a more in-depth briefing. If you do it online, we cover everything that you read and reviewed, ask if you have any questions, and you can ask, you know, more questions. You do get a little bit more focused attention on the one-on-one if you self-counsel, but a lot of the times people feel more encouraged to attend a group briefing because our foreman here may have questions that prompt questions that you come up with or that someone else. So there's an exchange of information because someone's more experienced on a move than someone else. You know, this may be a first time, it could be someone else's fifth time moving and they can tell you the horror stories. Or, hey, this is what you should do because this is the way it worked out perfect for me. Okay?
And then the follow-up is, which is the shorter timeline usually?
Neither. It's about the same. The only difference is normally if you were to come in and say, for example, you are doing a stateside move and you come in to me on a Monday, well, you just missed Monday's briefing. The next briefing is on a Thursday. If you're doing an international move, there's only one of those a week. So it depends on what day of the week you contact us to get scheduled for a in-person briefing versus instant satisfaction online. You can literally get your orders at 3 o'clock that afternoon, process your paperwork and call us the next morning and say, hey, I'd like to review my paperwork. That's the only speedy option. Okay, yes ma'am.
For like going internationally on these websites, is there a list of items that are like prohibited from being shipped for any of the carriers that you pay for?
Yes, they do tell you what prohibited. So if you were to go on the website would actually literally, the first screen you're gonna see is a list of, hey, this is what's considered house of goods, and then this is what unauthorized items. So normally the only unauthorized type of items is if it's a hazardous material. So household chemicals, garage chemicals, alcohol. We don't recommend obviously shipping perishable food because you're not getting a refrigerated shipment. So there are obviously some logic applies in there. Japan though, the way the system is set up, it'll say, hey, if you're going to Japan, we suggest you look at this site and here's the link. And it'll tell you what some of the restrictions are too. It'll tell you what customs requirements are. Japan has a restriction on weapons. Germany has a restriction on weapons. England has a restriction on taxidermy. So that's why you are suggested to go to those links to see what the restriction is. But the standard one for every location is hazardous materials, perishable food, not allowed. Okay. Any other questions? You can skip the slide. And one more time. So next slide. Okay, yes, sir.
POVs, you know, is it always just one? Is it?
Yes, so the way the POVs work is each military member is entitled to a shipment or storage of a vehicle. So if you're entitled to ship one, you can ship one, your spouse can ship one if it is a joint spouse assignment. But if your spouse is civilian, they're not entitled to a vehicle. And then, so Sergeant Foreman, if she's not married and she's going to Korea and she has a car, she's entitled to store it. Since you're going to Japan, you're entitled to store it. Captain Pico is entitled to store it. And that's the next thing, is I also recommend that you visit a website. I'm gonna give it to you right now. It is www.pcsmypov. So pcsmypov.com. You have to schedule an appointment. It used to take walk-ins, but during COVID, they've made restrictions and changes. You are required to schedule an appointment to turn in a vehicle for shipping, and you have to do it via that website. Plus, you need to learn what the restrictions are for a particular vehicle. So, if you have a bank loan on the vehicle and you plan on shipping it out of country, you have to get a letter from the bank authorizing the shipment, because what if you stop paying on your loan? They can't repossess the car that's now out of the country. So they need to know about it. If you have a vehicle that has some open recalls on it, you have to get those recalls repaired before you can turn in the vehicle, because they will not ship a vehicle that has the potential to break down overseas, because you may not be able to get the parts or get it repaired, and then you have a junker in a foreign country, and that foreign country doesn't want our garbage, basically, okay? So there are rules, so check that website if you're planning on shipping it. If you're planning on storing one, the two of you that are going to Japan, Korea, if you're not married, you need to get a letter from us that authorizes the storage. But we'll cover all of that when you turn in your port call request. We will cover that when you come in to schedule your move, because we're going to remind you that you need to take care of this stuff sooner rather than later. Any follow-up questions? Okay, if not, telephone numbers are there. Our location again is at the same building as finance. We are only open till 3, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday for walk-ins. And we close at 2 on Thursday and Friday because we conduct trainings. So we do answer the phones normally until 4 unless we're in training. So if you have a question, please feel free to give us a call. Don't just need to talk to me. All of my airmen are good. So just feel free to stop by, especially if you're going overseas, get me that port call request sooner rather than later. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Anybody online have any questions? I will check it when I get back to the computer. I know there were a couple of pending that are briefers that were not able to make it today would be the ones to answer, so I will get you that information after the class. Anybody in the room have questions? All right, folks, thank you so much for joining us. Have a great day.
Thank you.